podcast. This is episode number 30. So we are officially about to start a midlife crisis, according to this podcast, Age Now, which is wonderful. And on this podcast, we're just a group of guys talking about anything that really interests us, everything from Marvel stuff to sports, to just whatever's going on in our lives. We've only got half the cast here today, but there's still plenty to talk about. And also, just as a disclaimer, don't worry if my arm looks terrible. Someone just messed up a blood draw. I am fine. So just wanted to put that out there.
The person has been dealt with.
The person has been dealt with. Yeah, hopefully. I mean, geez, it was pretty brutal. So how's everybody been doing?
Raj, how you doing?
Exhausted, tired.
Your squid is at least smiling. Yeah, or your octopus or whatever he is. Yeah.
Didn't realize.
Now it matches everything. Okay.
Now it matches Raj Black Hoodie. Well, you know, yes. Peter, I'm doing good. Yeah. Shout out to my mom. My mom told everyone, she told me and my sister when we were in second grade, that she was always 30 and that she would never like not be 30. So every year we celebrate her 30th birthday, no matter what
That's
age.
Really funny.
Yeah. So this episode reminded me of that because it's episode 30. And so one day I walked into my second grade class and they were like, I was like, my mom just like, they were asking what our age of our parents was because like we're young and we want to know that. And I was like, my mom's 30. And my teacher was like, holy crap. Like yeah. Your mom is like
young,
like, super yeah. young. Yeah. She was like, okay, she's super young. So then my mom walked in. And then she was like, I'm not 30. Like to my teacher, like we're back to school night or whatnot. Yeah. And she proceeded to be called Baby Miss Curtis by my teacher for like years to come because I told everyone my mom was 30. So like I think she turned 48 for 9 a couple years ago, maybe it was last year, and we got her like 30 balloons. So
yeah,
like,
of course
it's a running gag, always 30. My grandmother I don't think ever turned over 22. She's been 22 for the last 50 years of her life.
That's so good.
We're just vibing with that. But yeah, that's what the episode reminded me of. We're doing good out here. I think the second week of school is completed pretty much. I think Raj and I don't have Friday classes. Peter, do you have any Friday
classes? I got two Friday classes, but I don't have a class, thank God.
Yeah, I know.
Spanish, so we'll be fine.
Ooh, Spanish.
Yeah.
I think Raj and I kind of decided today we might both take medical Spanish.
Seriously? That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I want to have.
I didn't even know it was a class.
That's awesome.
But I am nervous because I knew a lot of Spanish going into high school. In high school, I knew a decent bit of Spanish. Yeah. I took up a Spanish 4. I got my bad literacy stamp. And I haven't spoken like more than Puerto Ir Albano since I left Spanish. And now I'm like, I gotta read the course description before I like enroll in it next semester. Cause I'm like, if they're coming in with like, you need to know like Spanish 3 type knowledge, like you need to be able to like conjugate your verbs. Like, nah, that's not gonna work.
I mean, I'm assuming it'll probably be relatively basic. Cause it's just like, que te duele, like what hurts, like point to it. And like, then you can go from there. But yeah, that's a really interesting course. That's awesome.
Ay, 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 mi boca.
What is wrong with you? Your mouth? Why would your... Whatever. Ignoring you.
That's the amount of Spanish I remember.
Why is that what you remember? My mouth. Ay, 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 mi boca. Why?
I'm trying to remember when they taught us, like, remember when we'd been, like, elementary school or, like, they tried to teach us Spanish at a younger age in public school in Jersey? And like we would do the head, shoulders, knees, and toes song.
So I just that's it. All you remember.
I've reverted back to that.
Like, I remember doing it. It's funny.
From like fourth grade.
Unfortunately, yes. The other words I know, I'm not allowed to say because they are profanity.
Let's leave them
off the pod today.
Anyway.
For those listening, unfortunately, it is a little bit sad day. Today is Thursday, and we are recording this and releasing it tomorrow. So at this time, Queen Elizabeth II has died, which at 96, like what a legend.
Yeah, she lived a long life.
Like I saw the news story like yesterday or this morning that she was sick and the doctors were advising her to like be down. I was like, oh man, like I don't know, like she's 96 years old. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, she passed away later. It's like very interesting because like at least for Queen Elizabeth, I don't know much about the royal family, but I did know about her. It feels like she's kind of like transcended like a lot of like people just because like she's such a well-known figure over in England. Mm-hmm. Even like very famous like U.S. politicians and ex-presidents are posting about it.
Yeah,
and it's just crazy because it's like a person who's not really even involved in the government over in England. And it's just like, I don't know, it's weird that like
she's just like
she passed away.
And like everybody, yeah, like everybody's very involved in that. And I mean, it's crazy because like she's been the queen for 70 years. Like she was 26 when she became the queen.
Yeah.
And it's, I think it was like what, 1952 or something like that, she became the queen. Like that is insane. Like the amount of time that she's just like been like one of the most like famous and like well recognized like icons like in the world, like for that amount of time is like wild to wrap your head around.
And think about what you are in office for. Like, well, not even, it's not really office, but like think about what you see. Like when you're, if you took it in 1950, if you took control in 1950, you like you watched the end of World War II. You watch a bunch of other wars. You lived through the Cold War. You like lived through the boom of technology, mm-hmm. like the change in medicine, like multiple like pandemic level events. Just like you see like pretty much everything. And I talked to my grandmother about this before. Like she saw like even Queen Elizabeth and like my grandmother. They like were there for like Apollo 11 to land.
Yeah,
like that's it's crazy to think we went from that to like we're launching up shuttles all the time. We don't go back to the moon much now.
But because, we're launching like, things like every day basically like,
yeah, and we don't go to the moon because like it wouldn't be like a challenge. Like, that was the point of going to the moon, was like to show that we were like superior, mm-hmm. but we don't even need to do that anymore because it wouldn't be that hard.
It's like we so already crazy. Have all the information we like relatively need. It's
yeah,
like, okay,
we went from this being like a big task where those astronauts didn't know if they'd make it back home to now being like,
is it cost that effective could be a, like should
yeah
be,
exactly
like yeah it's crazy.
So it's just crazy to think that like someone's seen that much, and been at like the public. I mean, I can't even imagine being like under scrutiny and like being yeah. watched for 70 years. And there's been some stuff with the royal family, from what I know, like a lot of drama and stuff.
Yes.
And you're like there for 75 years of it. I mean, like they talk about how much presidents age in office.
Yeah.
And like here's yeah. Queen Elizabeth out here under public eye for 75 years, and she lives to 96 years old.
Yeah. Like there's the photo of Obama, like before and after both of his terms. Like he looks like he aged like 50 years. Like yeah. he came in, like he looked like he looked relatively young. I think he was like late 40s by the time he like became president. And then coming out of it, it was like he had like gray hair, like so many wrinkles. Like, it was crazy.
Yeah, I don't know. Just like a interesting thing to start off our podcast with. So,
yeah, a very historic.
Love the royal family. Yeah, we'll never forget the day. I mean, maybe I won't remember the exact day, but like, I'll be like, yeah, I remember where I was when Queen Elizabeth died. Cause like, they were talking about this is the first time anyone's going to take like the head of the throne of the royal family in 75 years.
Yeah. It's
like,
wild.
No one, barely anyone around. Like the life expectancy for a male is 73, so like not many people are around to see what the transition to power looks like. No one might be alive.
Yeah,
who knows what that transition to power looks like. So I don't know, it'll be interesting. I don't really have much else to say about it, but yeah. it'll be interesting.
I remember I saw a Philip DeFranco video on TikTok that told me the queen was dead, and I like my brain melted at that point. I was like, wow, this is where I'm getting my information from. That's amazing.
Mm-hmm. You'll never forget that. You'll be like, no. You'll tell your kids, like, I remember Queen Elizabeth died. I watched a Philip DeFranco video.
Yep.
Meanwhile, I was told by my x-ray tech as I'm walking to get a patient today. I'm like, hold up. Yeah. I'm like, hold up, what?
Yeah.
Imagine just like passing somebody in the hallway just because the queen is dead. Just like,
I'm like, huh?
Oh, wait
just
a minute.
In that, yeah, just in that type of way. I was sitting in history, and I had already known, I had already known the queen was like, sick and like being advised, like being watched by medical professionals. And then I saw someone say "rip the queen," and I was like, okay, someone's got misinformation, like she's just sick right now.
Yeah.
I didn't think it would happen so fast. And I like looked on Twitter, I was like, oh no, the queen's actually dead.
Yeah.
And my grandmother, not the one I was talking about earlier, but she's like really big in the royal family, like she follows it. And I was like, I texted my dad, like, hey, you gotta check on grandma, like the queen just died.
Oh my.
she's gonna be destroyed.
She's gonna be disheveled. Oh my god.
Yeah. Yeah, check on her.
That's hilarious. Oh my god. Yeah. Well, in other news, today's the NFL kickoff, as it just happened. It's the Bills versus the Rams.
Josh Allen with 2 points already.
They're currently driving down the field. Yeah, so this is the start of our fantasy football league.
Football's back.
Football is back. We're all incredibly excited about that because damn, it sucked not having sports for a long time.
Aaron Donald looks so scary.
Yes, Raj. Yes, he is.
That's a great take on the NFL season, Raj. Football, more than anything else, is just a vibe. Like, the cold weather, like, Sundays, just, like, watching games while doing, like, work in your room, like, chilling out. Like, I don't know. That's just, like, a vibe for me. Like, I'm excited to, like, watch football this Sunday and just kind of, like, hang out. And actually, no, I have volunteering on Sunday. But let's pretend I could on Sunday do that. That's what I would look forward to doing.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's nice to have football back. Again, nothing's been really going on. The track season just concluded today. So even those, like, small meets that were going on, I was watching, but not like football. I mean, the most important thing is we all have a horse in the game right now because we have fantasy teams. And
yes.
I, for one, at least spend way too much time worrying about my fantasy
team. Checking the rosters, looking at their injury reports, like looking at waiver wires. Just
not even that. I just stress out so much. Like, it's so bad how much I care about fantasy football, like, especially my family league, because I talk a lot of crap in my family league. I'm like the one who knows football the most.
Yeah.
And like sometimes things are out of your control. And I talk a lot of crap, and sometimes, you know, I didn't do well last year, and I have to prove myself this year. So, like, my players need to play well.
Yeah. Oh no, I'm the same. I get so stressed watching football, especially when, like, I like the team. And I just realized, I don't think we talked about, I think this would be the first podcast since the Backyard Brawl. I just realized that.
Oh yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the first one back. So
38-31.
For those who don't know, Pitt and West Virginia University have a very long-standing rivalry in football. Although Pitt has been pretty dominant over the past couple of years. I think it's like a 60-something to 40-something series. And I think like one tie or something like that. But it's been very interesting, the post-game, because we did win in a very kind of miraculous way. Pick six right towards the end of the game, and then a drop pass to seal the game away by West Virginia. During that game, I know at least Raj and I, we have our Apple Watches. We were checking our heart rates. I think Raj's was around 150, and that's awesome. And I think my heart rate, I think the peak was 175. I think my heart rate was at one point. It was when West Virginia was driving right before the pick. And then my heart just like slowed down because I was like, oh my God, we're winning. It's okay. I don't have to panic anymore. But yeah, like I get so stressed when I watch any kind of football all the time. It's crazy.
I think that says you need to do more cardio.
We lost our voices.
Oh my God. Well, because we also did paint some interesting words onto ourselves, which
we could say it on the pod.
I guess it's already on social media.
Yeah.
We did paint on ourselves JT sucks toes because there's a very infamous photo of the West Virginia quarterback sucking a woman's toes. We're assuming it's consensual, so I don't know really what else to say about that.
She did take a picture of it. So
it was I'm pretty sure it was a Snapchat selfie of it. I think
and he sent it to someone else.
And he sent it to somebody.
Oh,
so
interesting.
Yeah, I don't really know. Oh my God, I just realized it was Gabe Davis that caught that touchdown. He's on my fantasy team. I'm so happy right now. Anyway, he's actually on both my fantasy teams. But yeah, it was an absolutely amazing atmosphere at that game. Because it's a huge rivalry. West Virginia, Pitt lives rent-free in West Virginia's heads. Because
for sure.
Because they just, like, I don't know what their deal is. They just love telling us to eat some excrement. If you can get the ring to that, it's eat blank Pitt.
Rhymes with Pitt.
Yeah, rhymes with Pitt.
Starts with us.
Yeah, and they try so hard to just always say that, and it's funny the first time, but then when you hear it 75 times, it's like, okay, this isn't creative at all. And also when we win, it's like, you can keep saying that all you want, the scoreboard speaks for itself, so don't really care.
Yeah. I was pretty stressed out for a while, I'm not gonna lie. I was sitting by a bunch of West Virginia people because I was in like general admission, which I shouldn't have been there. It was like a little stressful the whole time because I was like, somebody actually bought those seats probably. So like I was like, we could get kicked out at any moment because there's no seating over in the student section. But I was like getting a secondhand embarrassment for a while because like it didn't look good. And I was like, oh my God, if I'm sitting over here.
Yeah.
Like, they were like cordial. They weren't going to like like tear us down, but they were definitely gonna talk their stuff, and I was like, I don't want to hear it. Like, I was like, I want, like, this is gonna suck. I was like, I was talking all this crap about how we're gonna destroy them today, and I was like, if we lose, it's gonna be so sad. I'm gonna be so embarrassed. And thank God we won, because it was great seeing that. Like, when they got the, we got the pick six, and everyone was like cheering. The West Virginia fans were dead. Oh, they're sitting down. They were quiet. They were upset. And I was like, this is great. Like, this is the peak of my life.
Exactly.
And then there's the West Virginia fans in the our student section. I don't know why they decided to do that.
They came through like the top part. I don't know. I think it's because security, like, there's only so much security can do, and there's so many people there. Because it was the biggest event at Heinz Field / Acushnet Stadium. Because it was like 70,600 people there. Which is more than there are seats, so people just bought standing tickets, which is crazy. But yeah, there were a ton of West Virginia fans in the student section.
I don't know why they decided to do that. Maybe they wanted to chirp, but
they did.
I saw, yeah, obviously, but I saw a lot of Snapchats of people recording them, and they're just sitting there like,
because that's the thing. It's like, if you're gonna come into the student section, you better get ready if you don't win to catch some heat. Like, it goes both ways. Like, if you want to talk trash, you're going to get trash talked at you. Like, just how the cookie crumbles, man.
And you know
that's
what?
Ultimately would be... Go ahead, Roger.
I was just going to say, we're just going to see him in Morgantown next year and do the same thing.
Yep. I'm really excited for next year, because likely it'll be our senior year. Raj and I's schedules for sure will lighten up a little bit more. Peter, I have to imagine yours will too.
Yeah.
It'll be exciting, because like, I'm totally going to Morgantown. Like, that'll be so fun. So looking forward to that. I mean, part of being a fan is being able to deal with like the flack. And if you're gonna talk crap, like, you're gonna have to accept it. Oh man, there's a fire truck. I hope no one can hear that. Shout out to like a pod we did a really long time ago where we had a fire truck appearance. But anyway, part of being a fan is being able to catch the flack, and I hate when people can't take it. Like, I remember we lost the Miami game last year, and we were walking back, and we were getting like, not like heckled, but like a lot of fans were like talking crap to like me and my family. But like, you just take it. Like, that's, I was talking crap during the game, and like, it goes both ways. As long as no one's like assaulting you, then like, I don't know, you just gotta deal with it.
Word, like, I know I heard about a kid from Pitt that got jumped by West Virginia fans after the game, and they actually broke his leg. That was
classy.
Yeah. Oh no, very classy. And then as we were walking through the parking lot, you just had West Virginia fans who were clearly, it was a group of three of them. So one of them was clearly driving home. They were all drinking, though. So, you know, got to love drinking and driving. It's so good.
Absolutely.
For everybody out there. Yeah. I told them to stay classy.
Not actually.
No. Yes. The very sarcastic, please don't drink and drive, for the love of God. It is so dangerous. But it was very fun. But probably the all-time quote of the night was some random guy that was rooting for Pitt that was walking through the parking lot as well. And it just stood, nobody just goes, they're quiet now. And just keeps walking. It's like, okay, like, cool.
Well, yeah, good for you.
Dude, and the amount of trash they left in the parking lot.
Yeah, it was bad. Like, people were spiking bottles and stuff, so there was just glass everywhere. It was, it was a real classy moment by West Virginia. Yeah.
I was drinking some iced coffee going into the stadium, and I, like, finished it up real quick. Like, I had to get to the trash can, like, right outside the stadium and make sure I throw it away. And the whole trash can was just, like, overflowing. So I, like, put the iced coffee like right on the top of the trash can and was like, sorry, like, I can't put it in the trash can, it's too full. I don't really know the solution to that, but I feel like there needs to be more trash cans, because like, even though you'd hope other people throw out their stuff, like,
they're not going
they to. Don't but if you don't have enough trash can space and like there's nothing else to do, like, I didn't have any place to put my cup, so I was either gonna get yelled at as I walked into the stadium, or I could have like put it on the floor near the trash can and hope that like someone took it out. So game was wild.
It really was.
We talked about last time how I have a bunch of freshman residents that I look after, and I was talking to a lot of them. And like, they were like, yeah, it's crazy. Like, our first football game was a West Virginia game. And I was like, it's wild. I mean, our first football game, it was COVID, but like Austin Peay 55-0.
Oh,
last year we played Last year we played a really joke game, I think, for the first game of the
year.
It was UMass. Yeah, it was a cakewalk.
Yeah, UMass.
I think we dropped like 45.
Yeah, and those games are fun because like you get the automatic dub, but people are leaving after halftime at the third quarter.
Yeah. So it's like
just to get home early because it's not a good game. But just to see like everyone be hyped till the very end of the game, and just kind of see. I mean, we had a good football year last year, so I think a lot of people are looking at the Panthers right now, and it was just cool to like get the recognition and also have a good competitive game. I would have rather had that game and win than blow out West Virginia because I think the energy was there the whole game and it was really fun. Definitely didn't have my voice the day after.
Oh no, yeah, I was like even during that game. Like Raj can attest to this. Like when we had the pick six, like I wasn't even celebrating. I was like on like another level. I was like just in pure shock of like what was happening. And like the next day, I woke up. I'm like, what is happening? Like I couldn't like speak at all. Completely lost my voice. I was still like had like so tired because we were up till like 2 a.m. trying to get out of there because traffic was so bad. Like it was absolutely insane. So you know, like waking up the next day and just rolling into Spanish class was wild.
I don't know how you did that.
10 a.m. Spanish class. I walked in there and there was a dude in the seat behind me that lost his voice even worse than I did, which was crazy.
All right, so you ready for this?
Yeah.
I got home. I got to my girlfriend's apartment at 1 a.m. Me and my friend and her, we ate some pasta when we got home because we were a little hungry. And I walked back home. I went to bed at 2 a.m. I woke up at 5 a.m. To go shadow in the pediatric ICU. So I slept 3 hours. My voice was like gone. And I like got into the ICU to like talk to the people. And they were like, oh, didn't you guys have a football game last night? I was like, yeah. And then like they were sitting there doing rounds. And I was like fighting going to sleep. So I was like standing like the whole time, like listening. And I was still like fighting the urge to fall asleep, like fully upright. I got home after that and I just crashed for like 3 hours. To make up some, it was absolutely wild. But it was a Thursday night game, which makes it tough because, like,
yeah,
we have stuff to do on Friday.
Yeah, yeah, it really was because, like, Friday, it was like, I think we just sat in our house, like, the entire day pretty much. It's like, I don't want to do anything.
Like just frozen.
Sleep. Like, yeah, exactly.
We didn't go to the gym. I think I left my room a total of, like, 2 times.
Oh, my, yeah. I saw you during one of those times and you're like, I haven't left my room in 13 hours. And this is like 6 o'clock and you're like, I just woke up.
And this is like a raspy voice. I'm like,
yeah, I just woke up.
Yeah, it's just an exhausting experience going to a game the whole day. Especially if you're like screaming and yelling the whole time.
Yeah.
I mean, you're talking about for a 7 o'clock game, getting there at like 2 p.m. to start tailgating and then going in, and the stadium opened at 4:30, then chilling out until 7, and then the game lasts till 12. You get home at like 2, and it's just like it's a long. That's like a more than a work day, and then probably had classes. We had classes in the morning, so like,
yeah,
it is what it is. But
it is what it is.
I went to the gym in the morning.
Oh my god! Wait, I had. That's where the blood draw happened the next day. That was the Friday because I got it done on Friday. That's why this happened. And the guy was
maybe your phlebotomist had a little bit too much fun at the football game, and that's why your arm.
Oh, you know
up.
What? That must have been what it was, because he was probably just having such a good time at the game that he's like, "Oh yeah, like I could see your vein." And because I was so confused, like when he was doing it, it was so weird. Like I'm sorry to just take a complete detour, but like because like I have like fairly defined veins, like it's really not hard to find them. And then he's like, "All right, squeeze your hand for me." I'm like, okay, like, can you not see? I mean, he already has, like, the tourniquet on my arm, so I'm like, can you really not see this? Like, all right. And then, like, I have to, like, squeeze my hand, like, open it up, whatever. And then as he's doing it, this is going to get very nasty for any listeners that are, like, squeamish about, like, blood or anything. Just skip ahead, like, 30 seconds. But he, like, poked it and then started, like, moving it a little bit, like, in my arm. And I was like, like I didn't like say
Roger,
anything.
Roger, are you trying to lose us viewers right now?
Stop with the fake. Stop. You don't have actual needles in them, or we're gonna get demonetized anyway. Stop.
We can't get demonetized if we're not monetized in the first place.
What's gonna help, genius?
Midlife crisis.
Please support the podcast.
Please support the podcast. Yeah, but it was just very. It was a very weird experience because it hurt more than like they usually do. Because, like, obviously I've had blood drawn before for, like, these, like, TB tests. And, like, before it was just, like, you know, little pinch, nothing else, it's fine. But this like actively hurt after I left, like almost immediately. And I was like, that's weird. And
then, something's
like,
off here.
I know. I was like, that's like really weird. Like, whatever. And it like hurt like for like most of the day. It's kind of just like sore. So like, yeah, it's fine. Then I wake up the next day and it's just like black. And I'm like, oh, that's good. That's really good. Because there's like, you can't really see, again, sorry for any viewers, but like these like very defined like purple-ish lines were like all over my arm, like everywhere. It's a lot better now. It's kind of just like a solid bruise. So it is healing, thank God. But it was very bad for a little bit.
Yeah, for any listeners or viewers that can't really make it out, it literally looks like a crime scene on like Peter's like arm.
It's like, and big too, because it's like not only is it down my arm, it's up my arm. It is up from where they actually would take the blood. So like, I don't even know how that happens.
And really, what I would, at most, what you expect from a blood draw is like you might have like a little bit of bruising like on the vein itself, like in the elbow junction, not all over your arm.
Yeah.
Like sometimes you don't really even expect to have a mark, but at most you expect to have just a tiny bruise, not one that's like over your whole arm, and you literally can't cover up.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like it's never would have expected that, especially from our Lord and Savior UPMC, but I guess that happens every once in a while.
It is what it is.
Oh, well, y'all rocking with internal bleeding?
I guess we are. Well,
back to the football season.
Yes.
We'll get a few predictions on the pod so that we can be wrong about it and bring it up in about 4 or 5 months' time. What is everyone's Super Bowl? Actually, we'll start there. What are you thinking about going into the season? Like, where do you think your team's going to go? Like, what are your kind of just what's on your mind entering the NFL season, like, as a whole?
Me. Let's see. Eagles season to prove. Bengals season to prove there weren't a Cinderella team that just made it to make it. Let's see. Bucks, you know, the Bucks are going to win that division probably. I'm like going division by division. Cowboys, we know every year, oh, we're going to go win the whole thing, whatever. Eagles. Exactly. They're going to go to the playoffs, either be a first round exit, or the Cowboys are just not going to make it and be terrible. Whatever. Let's see. Bills, they are the favorites right now. Like, I'm looking at all these like posts on Insta from like all these like analysts.
Jesus.
It's been a long week. Give me a break. But yeah, as so many people have the Bills as favorites and Josh Allen as the MVP favorite. It's the Bills season to prove as well, because I'm waiting for the famous Stephon Diggs picture after they lost of him just staring.
Yeah.
If they make the Super Bowl, that picture's gonna be everywhere. It was two years ago that Stephon Diggs was watching.
Now he's in the Super Bowl.
But now he's in the Super Bowl. Revenge season and two tough face emojis.
Yeah. For the Giants, I'm just hoping they win like 5 or 6 games. I literally don't care at this point. My expectations
6 would be good.
My expectations for this team are so unbelievably low, and they somehow manage to like lower my expectations every single year. But you know, we'll see. We will see. But I think it's with the amount of people that are choosing the Bills, there's no way they're going to win the Super Bowl.
Yeah,
they are so jinxed at this point. Like, there's no reason why they shouldn't. Like, if they have everybody healthy and nothing goes wrong, it should be them versus – it should be, like, them and, like, the Chargers in the AFC Championship game. Like, the Bills should win because they just have more experience in the playoffs. And then it should be either the Bucks or the Rams on the NFC side. And the Bills should absolutely win because during the game right now, they look very, very good.
They do look very good, right?
They look very good against the reigning Super Bowl champions. Mm-hmm. So I think they should win. They are still my prediction to win. But with everybody saying they're going to win, there's literally no shot they're going to win now.
Hey, if you think about this right now, in another universe, Josh Allen won the coin toss and this would have been the Super Bowl.
Yes, you are so right. In another timeline, that 50-50 chance, it's split. And then the Bills went on to win the Super Bowl that year instead. Yeah.
What's very interesting about this season is a lot of teams have a lot to, like, this is a year of like proving themselves. I mean, you could just go down the list about like the number. Like, I didn't feel like last year that many people had things to prove. This year, pretty much everyone does. If you just go like for our Eagles Raj and I are Eagles fans. Jalen Hurts has everything to prove. Tua Tagovailoa,
yeah.
Tagovailoa has everything to prove.
Oh, Trevor Lawrence.
Trevor Lawrence has
a lot to prove. Zach Wilson, when he comes back, has a lot to prove. Trey Lance has something to prove.
Danny Dimes, Russell Wilson Saquon has something Barkley, to prove. Like, yeah.
Danny Dimes, Saquon Barkley, Justin Herbert. I think Patrick Mahomes has something to prove. He doesn't have Tyreek Hill with him now. Like, what?
Oh, God.
What? The receiver caught the pass and got it stripped out of his hands, and it's an interception for Josh Allen.
L.
Sometimes L. You're the bug, sometimes you're the windshield.
See, this L. is what I hate about fantasy. It's the receiver's L. fault, and they make it still the quarterback's loss.
L.
For context, people, in the Bills game, an interception happened, and Raj is pretty upset for his fantasy team, but we are going to keep rolling there. But anyway, like, a lot of people have a lot to prove. Either someone, like, there's going to be disappointment this year. Like, not every team is going to get what they want.
Obviously, yeah.
And it's going to be interesting to see what happens with the fallout, because I could probably name 10 teams that if they won the Super Bowl, I would not be overly shocked. And I'm going to do a little experiment here. I would not be shocked if the Chargers won the Super Bowl. I would not be shocked if the Chiefs won the Super Bowl. I would not be shocked if the Broncos won the Super Bowl. I would not be shocked if the Bills won the Super Bowl. And I would not be shocked if, I'll just say the Raiders. I wouldn't be shocked if they won the Super Bowl. That's five on the AFC.
Yep.
On the NFC side, I would not be shocked if the Bucks won the Super Bowl, the Rams won the Super Bowl. I'm going to be honest on that. I would not be shocked if the Packers won the Super Bowl.
No.
49ers, I would not be shocked if they won the Super Bowl.
Especially if Lance
is good. And then, yeah, exactly. Especially if Lance is good. That's four on that side. That might be it on that side,
but that's still but nine probably, teams that you can. That's still nine teams winning the Super Bowl,
and I think I might. I forgot the Bengals, and the Ravens. That's 11 teams I could see winning the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
Do I think some of those have outside chances? Yeah, but that's 11 teams that you think have a chance, and that's what's crazy about everyone picking the Bills to win is. And I mean, I think the Bills. I just said it. I think the Bills can win a Super Bowl, but so many people are picking them. And it's now just, suddenly people are starting to realize why is everyone picking the Bills? And they are a good team. And I think they should probably be around the fourth best odds to win the Super Bowl. But, like, there's a lot of good teams. So I don't understand why so many people are picking them.
I know. And also, like, I don't know why people are underselling how good the Rams are still. Like, they have everybody back on that roster.
Rams are my pick to go back.
Except for Andrew Whitworth.
Except Whitworth and Odell. But they replaced Odell with Allen Robinson.
Von Miller.
But, like, again, it's like they're still the Rams. Mm-hmm. And it's, of course, everybody's got their critiques of, like, oh, well, they keep trading their first round picks. Well, go kiss their Lombardi trophy they have in their locker room now. Yep. Like, I don't know what to tell you. It works.
And you know what happened to their first round pick? They sent his ass to Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
The last time they drafted somebody in the first round was Jared Goff. And they're like, hey, let's never do that again. Ever.
Wait, what quarterbacks from that draft class are still playing? Like,
from
starting?
Goff's draft class?
Because I know Wentz is starting. Goff is starting for Detroit. Who else is from that class?
You're really, like, trying to, like, pull out my knowledge, like, the 2016 NFL draft. Like,
I have no idea who's
I don't remember
draft.
What the QBs were from that draft.
I don't know.
So we'll just skip. I think we should just skip this segment.
I don't think
it's landing.
We need Jacob here for this.
Oh, yeah. Just the encyclopedic knowledge of just any random crap you need.
Yep.
Oh, my God.
Raj, what's your outlook for the Eagles season?
Listen, in a perfect world with all the weapons we have on paper, we are definitely going to finish above 500. I'm locking that in. We should definitely finish above 500.
That's 1,000%. That's above 500.
I'm not done. Okay. Hold up. Also,
I'm not finished.
But being a fan of a lot of Philadelphia teams, I am very used to disappointment year and year and year again. So I don't want to be too hopeful here. I think the Eagles are going to win the NFC East. I think they're definitely going to win the NFC East. A playoff push-wise, I don't know how far we're going to make it, but I'm just setting it at...
Are you saying, like, wild card, divisional, like, championship game?
Now,
like,
I'm getting there.
Okay.
Give me a second. So, setting the line at... I hope the Eagles finish above 500. That's a lock. And I think they're going to play in the wild card game, and that's all I'm leaving it at.
Okay.
So, you think they're going to be wild card exits?
Like I said, that's all I'm leaving it at.
Here's where I'll go one further than you, Raj. If they don't win the first round playoff game, then the season was a disappointment. They made that game last year. they acquired AJ Brown, the whole roster just simply got better. Like, literally no one left. That whole team is running it back, except this time now you have AJ Brown,
James Bradbury.
You have Gainwell, who we drafted, which just puts more depth. You have James Bradbury. You have
Jordan Davis,
Hassan Reddick. N'Kobe Dean, Jordan Davis. Like, the roster is really good. Yeah. I don't care if you get the Rams in the first round. That sucks. Sometimes you have to do better than you did last year.
And the thing is, I think about the Eagles is that they're just one of those teams that, like, they're almost like the 49ers in a sense. Or, like, they're just one of those teams you don't really want to play. Like, when they're playing well, like, it doesn't matter what their record is. You don't want to be playing them because they will fight hard till the bitter end, unless they're trying to tank, which, you know, we'll throw that one out the window. But as another asterisk.
Yeah.
But, like, they are just, like...
Still mad?
What, that you guys actively tanked and got us knocked out of the playoffs? I couldn't give less of a damn. It's the Giants, okay? They're going to get smoked anyway. Who cares? But, no, because my thing that always pisses me off is that every year the Cowboys somehow are still Super Bowl contenders above the Eagles. And I hate both of those teams. Don't get me wrong. But why on God's green earth are the Cowboys ranked higher when they actively got worse in this offseason? Like, across the board. They lost their number one receiver. They lost both tackles, one to free agency, one to injury. They lost one of their key edge rushers to free agency. They didn't draft well. What did they do well? Nothing. They literally got worse.
And if you go position by position, the Eagles' offensive line is better.
Yes.
The Eagles' wide receiving core is better. The Eagles' tight end is better. And the Eagles' running backs are better. So the only thing the Cowboys are better at is quarterback.
Yes.
And then on the defensive side of things, the D line for the Eagles is going to be better.
They are monsters up front.
The Cowboys have a better linebacking core. The Eagles have a better cornerback core.
Yes.
And I don't know about safety. I don't know about
the Eagles are going to be the only thing. Because, like, Cowboys.
Oh, we got Gardner.
Yeah,
Johnson.
Well, I think we're
CJGJ. Yeah, like, you are. Yeah. That's because I think he might be a slot corner, but
he played most snaps at the slot. Yeah.
Yeah. So he, like, and again, fine. They have Trayvon Diggs, who is the Jameis Winston of the defense. We all know this, that, like, he gets a lot of interceptions, but then he also gives up a lot of yards. But overall, the Eagles have so much depth of talent. It's crazy. Fine, maybe they don't have the number one at everything, but the fact that they have Darius Slay and James Bradbury is a disgusting combination. Because Darius Slay can hold his own as a number one, and if you got one of the... I think CJGJ, or Gardner Johnson...
CJGJ.
Yeah, is... I think he might be the best slot corner in the league. Like, he is really good. And having James Bradbury as a number two corner is ridiculous. Like, that is absurd. Like, he had a Pro Bowl year, like, 2 years ago. He was, like, on the Giants last year. But
Darius
Slay
was ranked number, like, two by Pro Football Focus. He's really good in coverage. He's like, it's like Jalen Ramsey and Darius Slay.
Yeah.
He does not get a lot of flashy interceptions, but that's because he doesn't go for them. He tries to lock down his guy. He doesn't risk jumping routes. He doesn't lose his position on the back line. Like, you just see their just play happen with the Rams. Like, their cornerback's, like, laid off, but they were able to make the tackle. Like, Trayvon Diggs, like, runs for those balls and tries to intercept them, which, like, when you get takeaways, it's great, but when you get burned, it's really bad. So the Eagles have a really good team. They need to win a playoff game this year. Mm-hmm. Or Jalen Hurts, unless it's not a Jalen Hurts problem, Jalen Hurts is not going to be on this team next year.
Ooh. I agree with Justin on that. If Jalen Hurts cannot perform with all this talent on the team, we're either drafting someone or we're trading him away and getting someone else.
And that sounds harsh, but... Not only do I think that's what should happen, the Eagles drafted Jalen Hurts after Carson Wentz 2 years ago was going to win the MVP award until he hurt his knee. Like, they were ready to move off Carson Wentz really, like, that fast. So they're going to move off. We have two first round picks next year, maybe three. They're going to move up. They're going to draft a quarterback, or they're going to trade those picks and try to get a quarterback who might not be happy with his situation, which we can hope can happen if, like, the team doesn't perform well. So the Eagles have a lot of expectations this year. I'm excited to watch what they do. I didn't get to watch a lot of Eagles games last year because I couldn't, like, wasn't in market. But then NFL dropped this whole NFL Live Plus thing, so now I can watch their games. So that's pretty hype.
Dalvin Cook's brother, James Cook, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
His first carry, he fumbled.
Yep. And that's why he's
from Alabama.
No, he's from.
Or is he Georgia?
Georgia, I think.
Georgia.
Yeah.
Dalvin watching this game, just shaking his head.
Yeah.
Jalvin watching this podcast just shaking his head. But who do you guys think, what team or what player has the most pressure on them this season?
Give me a sec. I need to think.
Honestly, I think Josh Allen. Just because of, like, all the people, just all the talk going around, like, that'll probably take a toll on QBs because you try not to let all that talk get to your head, like, oh, you're, like, a by far MVP favorite, and your team's by far a Super Bowl, like, winner, like, prediction-wise. So, like, that'll definitely, like, be playing in his head as he's maybe throwing a pass or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Josh Allen's a good pick. I mean,
yeah,
this team hasn't like they were both oh wow, interception. Oh wow, I think I messed effort on a fantasy team. That's a bad look. Anyway, yeah, I mean Josh Allen's got a lot of pressure. I mean he performed well last year, but eventually like your team needs to do well, even if it's not your fault.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm going Justin Herbert. I think the Chargers had the best roster in the league, up and down. So yeah. If you have the best roster in the league and you've never made the playoffs, and I understand that your division is stacked, like yeah. You get the Chiefs, the Raiders, and the Broncos. It's a stacked division, but you need to at least make the playoffs.
Yeah.
And if you don't make the playoffs, like unless there's like a ton of injuries, that team has the talent to make the playoffs, and it will be on Joe Burrow. I mean, not Joe Burrow, Justin Herbert. So yeah. I think he's got all the pressure in the world, and not I don't think he's playing for his job because he's superbly talented. But like
yeah.
the chirps going in the chirps in the background are going to start saying. He's not a playoff guy.
Yeah.
If he doesn't get to the playoffs this year.
Yeah. And I think a lot of that also falls on like coaching and stuff because like some of the decisions that were made were very stupid. But at the end of the day, it's like
Brandon Staley did not make good decisions last year.
That and also their special teams has always been atrocious, like whatever. But yeah. But again, you are absolutely right. He is like in one of those positions where it's like he's gonna start getting scrutinized where it's like, oh, he's just like he's a stat patter. He's gonna be like a Matt Stafford. For the longest time, where everybody just said, like, oh, he's got great stats, but he's not a playoff caliber quarterback. And then the second he gets traded to an actual decent team, he then goes, makes the Super Bowl immediately and wins it. But that's besides the point. I think somebody that is under a lot of pressure this year, I don't know. I think it's going to be weird for me to say this, but I think Mahomes is under a bit of pressure this year.
I can see that.
It's not necessarily like the most pressure in the league because I think that could fall onto somebody. I could honestly, that should be somebody like Daniel Jones. So it's like he has had time and time again where he needs to prove he's a good quarterback or not. If he's not,
no, he's playing for a ton of money because
yeah.
His starting job, like that's a guy who's actually like financial, like future yes. And like. How many generations of wealth you can pass on is exactly. Like at stake here.
Because... Like it's a very different situation though. And then yeah. With Mahomes, it's like, it's a very different offense that he's going to be like working with now because they don't have Tyreek Hill. And it's like, okay, well, is Mahomes just going to be able to whip it downfield to somebody like basically who made who essentially? It's like, was Tyreek Hill just like this, like lightning in a bottle player that like allowed Mahomes to unlock his full potential? Or is it going to be that Mahomes really is just that guy? And can just work with mm-hmm. anything in front of them. Because I think that's like what something that Rodgers has been able to do very well. It's like he hasn't had like before Davante Adams, it was like Jordy Nelson was like his greatest receiver he's ever had, or like Randall Cobb. And it's like they are both incredible players, don't get me wrong, but those aren't like out of this world talent like Davante. And it's like he yeah. had a lot of people before that he made look really, really good. So this is going to kind of be almost like a prove it moment for Mahomes where it's like, yeah, I can be that guy that can elevate the players around me. It doesn't necessarily matter who's playing with me, but if we can work together, then we're going to be absolutely filthy.
Yeah.
Wow. Matt Stafford with that pick he threw looks like he's back in Detroit. That was bad.
Yeah.
That was not, really it was bad.
Well behind him. Yeah, that was bad.
It was. I mean, this is the first week of the season. It's always sloppy. Yeah. What you were going on, Peter, I'm excited to see a mechanical Patrick Mahomes this year. I think he's going to be really tight with the football. I don't think, like, and hopefully he'll lose it up throughout the year, but I think he's going to, like, he definitely, he's known for, like, getting into, like, slumps where he's not really, like, focusing on his footwork and he's just being really loose. I think this year you're going to see a lot more, like, he's not going to be wild Patrick Mahomes. He's going to be sitting in the pocket, like, being very mechanical and just, like, trying to get first downs instead of going for big shots. And I'm excited to see it because I think he could unlock a lot there. And then hopefully as everyone gets more comfortable, as the team maybe starts playing well, he'll like kind of go back to his old self a little bit and hopefully he'll carry over some of those skills. Cause remember like 6 games last year, he was like throwing multiple interceptions
yeah,
a game.
He was bad.
He looked bad. And then he kind of got himself together for the playoffs. So it could be good. And I'm just excited to see like this is the next stage of his career. Like, he had a great, I mean, all-time beginning of his career with the weapons he had. But he had Tyreek Hill, who's, like, arguably the fastest guy in the NFL. And he had Travis Kelce, who's one of the best tight ends of all time. And he has a good supporting cast. So you've got the best offensive line in the league, arguably. At least one of the best. And he's got, a wide receiving group that I think it's okay. It's good. It's solid.
Different, though. That's the thing. Yeah.
But let's see what he can do with it. And I think this is, like, he's now been in the league for 5 years, I think.
Yeah, so he's a veteran now. Like, this is, his team. Like, they paid him $500 million to stay with him. Like, he's got to be able to prove it's like, hey, I'm here to stay. It doesn't matter if people can come and go, but I'm going to be consistent.
So I think it'll be really exciting. I'm really excited for the NFL season because, like I said, I think a lot of teams can win it. And there's going to be a lot of drama. And you will hear after week one, either Trey Lance or Tua or Jalen Hurts is going to play bad in week one. And we're already going to start talking about year three quarterbacks and
or Danny Dimes.
What's going on.
He's going to play awful anyway. It's fine.
But there are so many people that are going to be talked about week to week about how they perform. And I mean, for them, that kind of sucks. Before a fan, it's like, best. I'm going to be logging on, clicking First Take, clicking First Things First, like all these talk shows every single day.
Yeah.
And hopefully you guys will click the Washed Athlete podcast.
There we go.
Wow. Stephon Diggs looks angry.
Well, he watched them celebrate the AFC Championship game. So
he's just watching like that, like over and over again on his phone, like in the locker room. He's just like, it's like just like keeps going back, like the 10-second loop of him just standing there with his hands over his head, just nothing but that.
Okay, I have a little like thing I want to do real quick. But so on NFL, they posted a thing like predictions for like MVP, offensive rookie, all that stuff.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to go through the list and see what you guys want to say about it.
Okay.
So who do you have before first game going on right now? Who do you have locked in as your MVP for this season? Just based off all preseason stuff and everything from last season and going into this now.
Like,
I know it's hard to say, but
I hate to be like, everybody's saying Josh Allen, but like, he's gotta be like, he's got so much potential to be the MVP this year. He's got all the weapons he needs. He's got a great everything. Like, he's gotta do it. He has to.
Aaron Rodgers is going to go 13-4 with a bad wide receiving core and win the MVP for the third straight year.
Back to back to back.
That's crazy.
That's going to be one of
the first.
Take.
It might be the first time in NFL history he's going to cement himself as an all-time great.
You want to wait? You want to wait for my take right now? Because I'm about to say something wild.
I swear to God, if you say Jalen Hurts.
Oh no! Oh no!
I think, you know what? We've seen it before. Carson Wentz almost did it until he busted his knee. I think if Jalen Hurts can be the final piece of the puzzle for the Eagles and hold it all together, I think he can win MVP. Like, he has everything he needs to do it.
I want everybody to remember that Raj said this when Jalen Hurts tears his ACL.
This is going on the Instagram. Don't worry.
That's fine. I'll lock it in.
Just because you said this, Raj, he's tearing his ACL, and he is my fantasy quarterback in two of my leagues, and I hate you for that. Right? I absolutely hate you.
Okay. Let's go to the next one. Offensive player of the year.
Justin Jefferson.
Justin Jefferson's like an easy pick. I'll go Jonathan Taylor. I mean, it's an easy pick too, but I think
he's an easy pick. Oh,
I'll go Jamar Chase.
Back. There you go.
And Jamar funny Chase. Thing
wow,
is,
that was literally
like the top three.
That list I saw.
That was. Yeah. All right, defensive.
I'm gonna start this one off. I saw him at the low list. TJ Watt's gonna win Defensive Player of the Year. I think he's gonna like. With that team this year, they're going to be expected to hold a lot of teams down. He didn't get a lot of love last year, and people were kind of being like, he's got snubbed. He had a historic season. I think definitely like narratives matter. I think he didn't win it last year when he probably deserved to, and I think he'll win it this year.
I'm going to go with the sleeper. I'm going to go with Nick Bosa. He's absolutely disgusting. I think that defensive line got a lot better, and they're developing into a much better like unit. So I think he's got a good shot to become one of, if not the best edge rusher in the league. Because watching his film, it's literally just textbook what he's able to do. It's like a work of art.
See, this one's hard for me because I'm stuck between two picks. One is a very obvious Aaron Donald. The other one, it hurts my soul to even have to say his name.
Say it. I know who you're going to say.
Micah Parsons.
He's absolutely filthy.
Like, I hate to say it, but like he is a very
he's
good
that guy.
At what he does.
He is that guy. Yeah.
He's very good.
Yeah, he is.
Micah Parsons is ridiculous. He has a great chance to win it, but he won it last year, correct?
You won Defensive Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, Defensive Rookie of the Year. Okay.
Yeah.
Never mind then.
Okay, so going off of that, Offensive Rookie of the Year.
Give me Pickett or give me Depth.
Yes!
Give me Jameson Williams when he comes back from his injury.
That's a very valid pick. He could be absolutely valid.
Okay, I'll change mine just to, if Kenny eventually starts, I'll have
you Pickett. Traitor!
No,
you
wait,
traitor!
Wait, I'm not going away from the Steelers. George Pickens. M.F. Pickens.
Yeah.
He is going to throw... I don't know if they play the Cowboys this season, but I want to see him throw Trevon Diggs on the ground.
I don't think they do. Ah! He is going to be tossing fools the entire season.
Yes.
It's going to be ridiculous.
Defense Rookie of the Year.
It's going to be Aiden Hutchinson.
Hutchinson.
He looks filthy.
He
is Jordan Davis.
Shut up! There's no way! As Jacob would say, he's just a gap filler. He doesn't do anything.
I'm taking Davis.
Okay, last one. Coach of the Year.
Coach of the Year.
Matt LaFleur.
Give me Staley.
Nick Sirianni.
Shut up! Oh my God, the Eagles are gonna get they're not gonna win the division now.
Jalen Hurts is gonna win MVP. Nick Sirianni is gonna win Coach of the Year, and Jordan Davis is gonna win Defensive Rookie of the Year.
Of them are turning their
and
ACLs.
Darius Slay is gonna be the first cornerback in a long time to win Defensive Player of the Year.
Offensive Rookie of the Year.
Well, no.
Kenneth Gainwell.
2018. Steph, wasn't it Gilmore won Defensive Player of the Year?
Did he?
I thought. No,
maybe
I might be wrong. I might
that,
be wrong. Maybe
pass rushers have won it a lot recently, but
yeah,
I mean,
I'll
could be wrong.
I'm trying to think. What other awards do they give out of the NFL honors?
Let me see.
Who do we pick to win Walter Payton Man of the Year Award?
2019, Stephon Gilmore.
Okay, Gilmore, yes. 19.
Yeah, but then before that, it was like literally zero.
Yeah.
Voters.
Okay, go ahead. All right. Yeah, Justin, who do you think's winning Walter Payton Man of the Year?
I think I'm going to have to, dude, I think it is a lock for...
You have no idea who you're about.
Joey Bosa is going to win Walter Payton Man of the Year.
I think it's going to be Devin Singletary.
You heard it here first.
I am going to say...
Wait, Raj, who do you think it's going to be?
Devin Singletary.
I think it's going to be Jason Kelce. Has he won
it?
Ooh, Jason Kelsey's a good pick. Imagine if the Eagles won. Jalen Hurts won MVP. Nick Sirianni, Coach of the Year. Jordan Davis, Rookie Defensive Player of the Year. Darius Slay, Defensive Player of the Year. Offensive Rookie of the Year is Miles Sanders. And Jason Kelsey tops it off. A great
Miles
season.
Miles Sanders ain't a rookie, dude.
Offensive Player of the Year might be.
Okay.
And then, who? Do we have any rookies? Kenneth Gainwell as RB2 converts to wide receiver slot, has a historic season, wins Offensive Rookie of the Year, and to cap it off, the Eagles win the Super Bowl. Super Bowl MVP is also Jordan Davis, and then Jason Kelce accepts the Walter Payton Man of the Year Award.
I hope you realize that now, because you said this, they are all tearing their ACL, including Sirianni. Sirianni will tear his ACL because you said this. They're all going to be out for the entire season.
Oh, my God. Last award I can think of off the top of my head, Comeback Player of the Year.
Kimmy McCaffrey.
Bold.
I'll say Quan Barkley.
I'm trying to think who got hurt last season.
Who didn't get hurt
you
last
could
season?
You could do Nick Bosa.
Sleeper. Can I get a sleeper?
Yeah, go for it.
Derwin James, if he's on a really good roster for the Chargers.
Good. That's good.
If he's on a good Chargers team and that team plays really well, really well defensively, that could be really good for him.
Oh wait,
you know what?
Didn't get hurt last year. It was the year before.
I got all the running backs on the Ravens.
All of the running backs on the Ravens.
On the Ravens.
The Ravens roster.
They all
a committee award.
Yeah.
A committee award.
Yeah.
The Ravens running corps.
The Ravens running corps. God, just the Ravens and Titans teams from last year who just got injured to hell and back.
So bad. Feel so bad for them.
That was insane.
That's
but
all the NFL awards
I
know. So,
Well, that's good. I think we're going to transition off of the NFL because we are going to talk about Tier List Tuesday. We're talking about it again
on
the podcast. So for those who don't know, if you don't follow the Instagram, go follow Wash Athlete Podcast on Instagram. Drop it a like. This week, we followed this meme. You can see it on our screen if you're watching live. If not, I will narrate it for you. Essentially, there are animals on our screen, and you have to pick two, and they will defend yourself. and the rest will come to kill you. So here are the options. You can get 50 eagles, 10 crocodiles, 3 brown bears, 7 ox.
Okay, so first of all, 50 hawks, 10 hawks, okay. crocodiles, it's 3 grizzly bears.
Okay.
Specifically grizzlies, yes. Oh, God.
Wow, production going hard right now.
Okay. Yeah, so 7 bulls. Yeah.
7 bulls.
Yeah.
1 hunter, 15 wolves, 10,000 rats,
yes.
5, what do you call those?
Silverback gorillas, yes.
Silverback gorillas, and then 4 lions. So essentially what the tier list does is in the top row, you put the 2 that you want to defend yourself with. All the rest will try to kill you. So we did this for our tier list Tuesday, and we have our tier list that I think we're really passionate about.
Very.
And then we also have 4 viewers who sent their tier list and that we're going to get react to, because Peter has been hot about this. So Peter, tell me why this piqued your interest and why you're very passionate about your
so
list.
Listen, okay, so I need to make this very clear. I just randomly saw this meme the one time. I forget when I saw this, and I do bring this up to people kind of periodically, and there is a correct answer. And if you say anything else, you are just wrong. And I'm sorry. Because here's the thing. If you look at all these options, there should be one glaringly obvious option that you should be choosing every single time. You could split hairs on the other ones and say, like, oh, this one will be slightly better, whatever. That one I don't really care about. If you choose anything besides 10,000 rats and something else, you are wrong. Because 10,000 rats is so many rats. And the issue is that people are like, oh, they're just rats. They can't do anything. No, okay? If you have ever seen New York City rats, they are like this big and horrifying. And there's 10,000 of them. They could solo the entirety of everything because there are 10,000 of them. I don't care how weak rats are when there's 10,000 of them. There's so many. And it makes me so mad when people are like, oh, like the other two, like, oh, I'll just pick like the lions or whatever. It's like, no, you need to pick the rats and something else. You absolutely have to. Why? Raj,
stop spinning the screen. You're going to give our viewers a seizure. So now we've explained like what the rest of, Raj, I'm going to beat you. What we're going to do is we're going to go over our tier list. So, Peter, I will keep going with you.
Yes.
In your 2 defenders tier. Okay, I thought, there we go. In 2 defenders tier, you have rats and 50 hawks. 10,000 rats, 50 hawks. So,
wait, that's not
and then you have everything. Oh, wait, maybe I
had the bears. Labels.
Oh, wait, no, sorry. I looked at Raj. My B. Jesus. You have 3 grizzly bears.
Yes.
And 10,000 rats.
Yes. Okay, so my idea is the 10,000 rats are slowing down basically anything. And I do understand where people are coming from with the hawks. Like, you know, okay, they're aerial, whatever. But here's the thing. Grizzly bears are like 8 feet tall, like almost 1,000 pounds, and have like actual knives in their hands, like with claws. They are swatting those hawks away like nothing. And anything else that's even coming close is getting completely stopped dead in their tracks by the thousands of rats in their way. Because, you know, the one argument I've seen is like for like maybe like gorillas or something like that. But here's my thing. A bear is going to beat a gorilla one-on-one, period. But here's the thing. If you have a bear and then let's say 50 rats, right? Let's just say 50. There's still 9,950 rats left, okay? Those 50 rats are just distracting anything else. Because sure, maybe they're not doing a lot. They're like, you know, maybe nipping and whatever. But they, even though they have pretty decent, like, teeth and whatever, but they can be nipping at whatever. But they can climb things. So they would be climbing up said gorilla, going at eyes and anything else that is, like, somewhat vulnerable. And then bears are just cleaning up what's left because they are actual walking tanks and can fight like moose. And moose are enormous. They are not like horses. They are like 10 feet tall. They are ridiculous. But bears like hunt them and it's ridiculous. So bears and rats are soloing anything on that list. And crocodiles are just useless in anything but water, except that rats and bears can both swim. And I'm taking Bears. Like, I'm sorry. That's the only right answer. It's the only answer.
Valid. My whole logic was, you know, have the ground and aerial assault, but I mean, I see where you're coming
well,
from.
No. Your thing is like, oh, the Hawks will pick up the rats and then drop them down like paratroopers. No, they're still animals. You can't just be like, oh, they're going to form an air force in the middle of this, so they're going to be like PJs. Like, no, you can't do that. Okay.
Well, Raj, let's take a second to go through Raj's list. So Raj has 10,000 rats and 50 hawks in his top tier. He says that defeating every other animal will be pretty easy. And then he put face on a t-shirt, LOL, with a guy shooting a gun. So Raj, explain your tier list.
So face on a t-shirt, LOL, for the dude with the double barrel shotgun. He's done no matter what. Maybe you can take out one rat or one hawk. Or no, he has
to pick up more than one rat.
Yeah.
Like, I'll give him that much.
Yeah. He'll take out multiple rats, maybe two hawks if he has a good shot.
Yeah.
But human,
but anything else is smoking them.
Human gone.
Yeah.
My whole thing was, so I did say the paratrooper thing is a joke after the fact. My initial thought was, okay, if I have quantity of that many rats, I'm good on the ground. And the thing with hawks are they can always just swoop in from above. But Peter does also bring in valid points with the bears and everything. So I still like my whole ground air assault thing. Having the rats on the ground nibbling away while the hawks just swoop down and start pecking at their eyes.
Fair point.
That's my point.
You still chose the rats, so it's fine.
Yeah.
But someone here did not choose the rats, and that is Sir Justin Curtis.
You are psychotic.
Has always the best tier list. So here's what's going on here. We got 50 hawks and 5 gorillas.
You are an idiot.
The two defenders tiers. Listen up here, people. Take notes. Oh, the Bears, absolutely useless. There's a 0.0001% chance that the Grizzly Bears are defeating 50 Hawks. Outright. 0% chance. The Hawks will tear them apart. There's 50 of them. That means that you have like 15 per bear to attack.
So you're saying
going
gorillas
down.
Are
going
to do a better job?
Than the Bears?
Yes!
Absolutely.
Oh my
gorillas
god,
are
you're
way,
an idiot.
Gorillas are way more coordinated creatures. Way more coordinated creatures.
What, because they can move a stick? They don't fight! They bite things!
Do you see that thing? I would much rather fight a bear than a gorilla.
You
would tear
insane.
Me apart. Tear
you
me
are
apart.
Insane! You are so wrong! You are so wrong!
I would take 5 gorillas over 3 bears.
Okay.
No problem. I might take 1 gorilla over 1 bear, if I'm being
honest.
You are
insane.
But if I'm getting 5 gorillas over 3 bears, absolutely taking the gorillas. But anyway, I don't even need the gorillas to defeat the bears. The hawks got it. That got covered. Ready? 7 of the bulls or whatever that also tears. The hawks would take care
what
of that.
What are you doing against 10,000 rats? There's 10,000 of them.
I'm getting to that. So that's the bulls are in low difficulty.
Yeah,
also in low difficulty, the wolves. Come on, really? Like the gorillas got the wolves handled, and so did the hawks. The hawks are taking care of everything on the low tiers, including lions, wolves, bulls, bears. No problem, right? 10 crocodiles. The issue the crocodiles propose is that their skin is tougher, but I still think at the end of the day, the 50 hawks, they're fine. The
crocodiles can look up.
I don't think so either, but you gotta eventually get close to them anyway. But again, I think the gorillas are taking care of that too. The gun proposes a little bit more of an issue, right? Because a gun would take down a hawk, and a gun would also take down a gorilla.
Do you understand
there might be some
what
resistance.
Gun this is?
No. I do understand what I'm saying. Is I'm just taking it for reference, like as a gun, not like a semi-automatic. But I'm not trying to be like he's gonna have to take one shot and then take like a long time to reload.
Yeah.
But I'm saying he will definitely kill. Like I'm pretty convinced that no one on my low difficulty tier is even killing one of my animals. The gun would kill a couple of them. 10,000 rats. Listen, I understand 10,000 is a big number. I also understand rats, and they would run away.
You're confused. You are confused as to what this is. It is not about like how they would actually act in real life. These are bloodlust. Like they are trying to kill you and trying to.
No. Because that doesn't. Okay. Number one. Sure. Let's say that. Say that the rats are specifically trained to go kill, right?
Yes.
I still think the hawks and the gorilla present a big enough threat, a big enough front that, again, they're not going to really attack. And I'm sorry. You're going to say they're bloodless rats. I don't know that. I'm saying I got 50 rats.
That's the point.
And they're trying I think if 50 rats had the intent to come kill me.
If you dropped all these animals in here, they're not going to just instantly start fighting. They're just going to walk away from each other. They're animals.
But I'm saying if the rats were put, like if we were put in an arena and the rats were told, you need to go, like they were programmed to go kill me and I was sitting in the center and I was defended by these bad boys, the rats, I think they'd be fronted with the apes and with the hawks and they wouldn't attack. And even if they did attack, I think it would take a long time. They're in the high difficulty tier. I don't think it's going to be an easy task, but everyone I keep talking to about this keep saying that the rats are going to like come, there's 10,000 and they're going to come attack. I would train my rats to go attack you. Like, you're going to train rats to come kill
that's
you. You don't have the time for this.
You're delusional.
Okay, so why would the gorillas or the hawks defend you? Are you training them?
Well, for the two defenders here, of course they're going to have to know that you have to
that's
defend
the
them.
That's the point of the discussion!
I'm saying that the rats would come and kill me. I am saying that the rats are told to come and kill me. What I am saying is that they don't know, their goal is to kill me. They don't know their goal is to also, they have to kill the hawks and the gorillas to get to me. And I think the hawks are swooping down back and forth, picking one off by one off. They'd get scared and they'd run away.
Okay. Can you do some math for me real quick?
Yeah.
Can you divide out 10,000 divided by what?
It should be 2,000.
It should be roughly 2,000. Is that what you're saying?
Yep.
Okay. So one hawk can get what? Two rats? Three rats at a time?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's max 100.
Don't forget my apes on the front.
Okay, so
just
that's
punching everyone that comes
back. Max 150 rats.
But I'm not even saying. But I'm saying that they're going to be deterred by my forces.
What are you? We're not doing intimidation factor in this.
We are totally. That's part of the list.
What do you mean?
All right, if we're just making up rules, my birds got metal claws and nukes on them. Then
like.
No, because I didn't put anything. I'm just going with how animals would behave in the given situation.
Yeah, and gorillas
and I'm still
aggressive. So why would they do anything?
But they're defensive.
Okay, so
and
then
saying,
if
and they're
gorillas
my defenders.
Are attacking me, then why would they do anything then? Why would they try to fight a bear if they don't have
to? See, I put gorillas in my defender tier. If they were in my difficulty tier, they would have been a lot lower because they're not really that aggressive. They're probably not going to pose much of a threat or fight. So that's why you'd put gorillas on a low tier. That's why a medium difficulty.
He thinks his gorillas are from Planet of the Apes. Ape, don't kill ape.
I don't think y'all understand gorillas.
I don't think you understand the premise of this meme.
No. I do understand what it's trying to get at. Obviously, if you have 10,000 blood-sucking rats who all coordinate their attack together, yeah, they're going to overwhelm everyone.
That's the whole point of it.
That's not reality. That's a stupid list.
Obviously, this isn't reality.
That would be making like the dream team of the NBA and be like, yeah, we're going to put them in the G League. I bet they'll win the championship. Like, that's ridiculous.
That's the point!
So how I chose to interpret the realist is that the rats want to kill me, but they don't know about the other animals. They're probably going to be deterred. Some will fight and they'll die, and others will try to run away because they're not going to like my gorillas down there scaring them,
okay,
and then the
fine.
Hawks are just going to sweep on.
Half
they
of
might
the rats don't
help.
Fight. That's still 5,000 rats!
The Hawks might even like line flap their wings a little bit, get some wind gusts, rats
this
out.
This isn't Pokemon! Bro, what?
Dude, you are
he's
just
so disgust!
Like, you are just saying things
what?
At this point. What are these things? Like, what
are the,
just
this,
saying
this, this argument that the rats are going to go fight and go take everyone down is
that's
just ludicrous.
The
that's not what they're going to do.
Oh, my God.
Justin, be
it's
like,
stupid then.
Oh
Raj,
no,
all the listeners can't see you.
Oh, my God.
Swipe my rats away, guys.
Oh my God.
The rats would not fight.
What? Then nothing
would
fight. You're
making an assumption.
Nothing would fight then.
I make assumptions about a lot of things. I'm going to make assumptions right here
that
the rats aren't going to fight.
If we're making assumptions here, you're saying the rats aren't going to fight. A lot of those animals won't fight then also.
Oh, I also agree with that discussion.
So then what's the point of the entire discussion if they're not going to fight?
Because it's stupid. That's a tier list.
My God. So wait, so what I'm hearing is that you agree if the rats in this scenario act the way they're supposed to.
No. I'm saying this scenario, if the rats were programmed in their brains to kill me and also kill animals in the way of me.
It says it in the meme. To defend you, the others will try to kill you.
No. They tried to kill me, not the other animals. They didn't specify the other animals. So I think the other animals would be a deterrent.
No, it does not matter. There are 10,000 of them. They'll go around you.
No, that's not what's going to happen because I got 5 apes. I would put them around me. The hawks would circle. They would be... Rats would run away.
Why are they running away if they're trying to kill you?
Because they're scared of the other... They're not trying to kill the other animals and they're going to be a deterrent. You think a rat is going to be happy to see a big...
But they are trying to kill you. They will kill you by any means. That is the point of this discussion.
I don't think so. I think you guys are way overestimating the power of the rats.
What the hell? What are you saying? Ludicrous. What are you saying?
This discussion is ludicrous.
You are a clown. You are a clown.
You're a clown.
These stupid technicalities to prove your point because you know you're wrong.
People listening know that I'm right, so you can put it in the comments section.
Why are you just saying they wouldn't attack? The entire premise of this entire thing is that
Raj,
turn
off your screen.
No, don't turn off your screen. But it's like two are trying to defend you. Obviously, in real life, they aren't going to defend you. They are animals. Obviously, in real life, rats aren't going to try and fight anything. They're rats.
Obviously, I also would like to be given... I'd also be like, given the context, I did not see the meme. I was never presented the meme upon making this tier list. So the specification of the others are trying to kill you was not clear.
I sent it in the chat.
You did not send the meme in the chat.
I said it said the exact same thing. Hang on. I'm going.
Regardless, I'm still going to stand on the technicality that the rats are going to be deterred by the other animals.
You're just,
but again, I agree. It's going to be high difficulty. I don't think it's going to be an easy task to get rid of the rats here, but I just think that they're going to be enough. They're going to be deterred enough. And yeah, that's what I'm sticking with.
Okay.
And people can let me know in the comments.
Pick two of the options to defend you. The others try to kill you, and you can make however many rows to explain how much trouble those other options will give your defenders. The number also got a bit cut off, so if you need clarification, let me know.
I did specify that if the rats are trying to kill me and they will also kill the other animals in the way and they coordinate their attack together, then yeah, they'll probably kill me and that probably would be OG. But also, you're choosing a 10,000 rats to defend you. I'm not sure 10,000 rats are really going to be that good defenders because any hawks are just going to fly right over them.
Okay, again, look, if you think about this realistically, none of these options are going to be able to win. Like, it's about which two options are going to give you the best chance of surviving. Obviously, if you actually think about it, if you have all the other options combined, they'll probably end up winning against no matter what two defenders you have.
But Peter, I'm just saying, look at your list here, right?
Yeah.
Grizzly bears, 10,000 rats. They're trying to defend you.
Yeah.
What? You're dead. Just by... Like,
why?
Send you... I'll put two hawks in. So there's two singular hawks. You're not winning.
Okay.
You think your grizzly bears and your rats are going to stop a hawk? You're dead in seconds.
Okay, so let's think about that. How can a hawk attack me if it's up in the air?
It's going to swoop down, and the grizzly bear is not as tall as you are. Even if it's close to as tall as you, it's not going to be fast enough to swipe the hawk out of the air, and the rats aren't going to do stuff. They're just going to be sitting over there doing rat behavior.
Justin... Grizzly bears are 8 feet tall.
What? I don't know the technicalities about how tall. They're not going to get up fast enough to knock down the hawks. And all it takes is for one hawk to take its freaking, like, beak thing or whatever it's on its face and just drill it into you and you're dead.
He could also just, you know, hit the floor.
I could also just get low and sit under a bear if I want to. Or something like that. Like, obviously...
Well, then the bear would kill you.
Okay, and then the hunter's just going to
I don't think a bear is going to appreciate you sitting under it.
Well, because then the hunter's just going to stand back and shoot me from a distance. Like, it doesn't... Obviously, if you think about this, it's not going to work. Obviously, this is a meme, okay? I'm sorry. It's a meme. Who cares? But it's which two options are going to give you the best to survive. And it's 10,000 rats and three grizzly bears. The grizzly bears can fight the hawks, okay?
I think the rats are useless defenders.
Why?
Because they're not going to do anything to defend you. If you have Hawks attacking you, the purpose of the rats is very little.
You also have everything else attacking. Let's think about that for a second.
I think I had the best two defending options against everything combined versus you guys. And the only technicality you're trying to get my list on is the rats. But I think the rats are like one of the worst defenders you could possibly have there. So who's the real winner here?
Because you're just saying it wrong. Like, you're just saying the rats aren't going to do anything because you just say they're going to get scared. And that doesn't make sense.
Well, I agree that if there were blood-sucking rats and they were going to kill everything in their path, then, like, they would be good attackers. But I still think they wouldn't be good defenders because, like, if a lion started running, right, and just started jumping, the rats wouldn't be able to react fast enough. They'd just be getting squished. The lion would make its way through, just bite your head off. Boom, you're dead.
Okay, so if it's a lion is running, how is it going to get through, like, 2,000 rats without getting at least a little bit tired and slowing down? Or, like, how are these rats not jumping on said lion as it's running? Like,
the rats are going to jump on the lion? Have you ever seen rats? Do you think they hop like a bunny?
Yes! Have you seen them?
Rats don't hop.
Have you seen New York City rats? They can move.
A doesn't specify New York City rats. B, if you can tell me that a rat can hop like a bunny, then we're having a different discussion here. I've never seen a rat hop before, personally. Exactly. I work with mice in my lab, and they don't hop.
Give me a sec.
Meanwhile, we're going to flash through some of our tier list here. We're running out of a little bit of time here, so we're going to go through. Shout out to Kenzie for submitting her tier list on the pod. She has 10,000 rats and 50 hawks in her defenders tier, which would be a pretty popular take. Interestingly, I think good choice. She has the wolves in high difficulty, which makes sense. I would put the wolves over, in that situation, I put the wolves over the lions and the gorilla because I think the more wolves you have against the number of rats, you don't really stand much of a chance with the hawks there. But, and then she has grizzly bears in low difficulty, crocodiles in low difficulty, and also the bulls in low difficulty. So thanks for submitting your list, Kenzie. And we are going to go over to Mark here, who would get, once again, another person who has rats incorrectly placed in the top tier with the 50 hawks, another example of that. But interestingly enough, he puts the bears in high difficulty versus the last time Kenzie puts the bears in low difficulty. He's giving a little bit of respect to the gun at medium difficulty. Next up, we have Jamie, who submitted her tier list, and we've got 10,000 rats again in the two defenders tiers, but then the gorillas make their appearance in the two defenders tier, but they had to move the hawks down to high difficulty, which in this situation, I think you'd be pretty screwed against the hawks. There'd be no aerial support. And then, again, gun in the useless tier. Against 10,000 rats, a gun is pretty useless. And then Dempsey's the last person to submit their tier list, and they're going to put the hawks and the wolves in the two defenders tier. They're going to put 10,000 rats in useless tier. So we've got Dempsey over here, I think, projecting the same thing that the rats would not fight and they would be deterred, which I totally agree that they would be deterred.
That just doesn't even make sense. It's just saying, oh yeah, rats don't count. They don't do anything. They're not an option. Everything else, though, they'll fight. The crocodiles, for some reason, will start running on land. They won't just immediately leave. The bulls, yeah, they'll fight. But rats, no, they won't.
I think as a defending option, the rats are not a great option. Like, defensive rats are not going to make it work. Offensive rats have a chance. That's, again, I have them in high difficulty for a reason.
Also, you better check the chat right now. I just sent a video of a rat jumping onto a flat surface and climbing up it.
All right, let's see here. And then after this video, we're going to close out the pod so it doesn't get too long. Let's see what we got over here.
I don't know what the context of this video is at all. It's
really out of context too. That's a pretty good jump, but I don't really think they're going to jump onto the lion like that. That rat was pretty impressive, though. He's cute. He's a cute rat. That was a pretty good hop, but again, I don't really think that there's a reason that the title of the video is Super High Rat Jump. And then there, and if you look in the description, after one failed attempt, this rat makes a huge jump.
Because he's jumping onto a flat surface, a completely vertical angle, and he jumps onto it and climbs it.
And then Brett also on this video commented that he jumped about 2.5 feet tall, which I'm going to guess that lions might, depends, but I'm still like, I'm not still buying this rat debate. I do respect the rats being in S tier. I'm not going to say it's a ludicrous take, but I think as defenders, rats are pretty pointless.
They're just wrong.
And that's what you ultimately chose.
Well, that's the thing is that like, if you have to choose them as defenders because there's no way to defend against them. There's 10,000 rats.
Yeah, but I have a better chance of defending against 10,000 rats and 50 hawks with no aerial
support. I
don't think
you understand how many 10,000 is. I really don't.
I think I understand how many 10,000 is.
I don't.
It's one more than 9,999.
Okay. You know what? Fine. You're wrong, but you're entitled to your opinion.
But I'm right. And with that, halftime of the Bills and Rams game is upon us. The Rams had it up 10-10 going into the half, which will make for an exciting second half. This will be the end of the Watch Athlete podcast. Any boys, do you have anything else to say?
You're delusional. You're delusional, Justin. Just had to put
that
out there.
And on that toxic note, this has been the end of the Washed Athlete podcast. Go to the description below. Comment on our tier list video. Make your own tier list. Send us that way. Use code WASH20 at buckthumb.com. And we will see you next.
Kenny Pickett will be ORY.